What's up guys, you're welcome to my YouTube channel, and in today's video I'll be sharing some, I call it a special for graduate school applications, because I'll be sharing some very important information about applying for graduate schools, and I got lots of questions about it after posting my achievements online. Yes, by God's grace I'm pursuing a PhD in electrical and computer engineering, and throughout this video I'll be trying to share some tips on how you can also get an offer like that. And you know, whatever I'll be sharing doesn't only pertain to the field of electrical and computer engineering, you can apply it to any other field as well. And so let's hop right into the video. The first thing that I want to talk about, I'll be looking down because I mean everything that I'm doing I've kind of like penned them down so I can work on my organization throughout the presentation. And so if you see me looking now, just know that I'm trying to get, you know, the points in order. Now, the first thing that I want to talk about is why a PhD and not a master's. So people were wondering, and the news outlets were also saying that I skipped my master's to pursue a PhD. Well, that is not the case, because mostly, if you are like me and you know that even after doing your master's, you definitely want to do a PhD, it's always advisable to, you know, attack the two head on, like, you know, kill two birds with one stone. So some US institutions and maybe some institutions in other countries allow what we call a direct PhD. So you can enter into a PhD program right after your bachelor's degree. And when you do that, along the line you do your master's. It's not like you skip the master's, you have to do the master's. Some people eventually, maybe after doing a master's, they decide that I don't think I want to do this anymore, then they decide to terminate their master's and then just leave and then maybe go and work in the industry. And so that is what happens, why a PhD and not a master's. And then the next thing that I want to say is that the reason why most people opt for a PhD is because a lot of the schools guarantee full funding for their PhD students. So they are saying, hey, as long as we pick you, that we want to work with you, so long as we are interested in you, we are going to be funding your education. And your funding can come through teaching assistantship, it can come through research assistantship, and it can also come through fellowship, maybe from the department and certain awards. And so these are some of the things that you would want to know. Mostly, it's a bit challenging getting a fully funded offer for masters, because I really don't know why, but some people are still able to do it though, but it's usually advisable, especially if you know you are definitely going to want to do your PhD, you just attack it head on. And so that is the first thing that I want to talk about. Now, I want to talk about a very important thing, that is like deciding what research you want to do. The first thing that I want to say is that you don't have to have it all figured out. Like, you don't need it all figured out. You don't even have to have a research topic in your mind. What I did was that I knew the courses that I took when I was an undergraduate, and I knew there were some courses that I knew I don't identify so much with this course, so I don't want to, you know, do it. And there were some courses that I was like, whoa, these courses, they came easily with me, I was so interested in them, and so I definitely want to try them. So those were my two things, like in deciding where I want to work. So basically you need to just have an idea of a field or a course that like it's very interesting to you, and then after you do that, you just search for, you know, people that are doing good things in those courses. Like, maybe so someone's interest can be, let's say, electromagnetics, and you can start. So maybe electromagnetics, then what are the various fields in electromagnetics, and then electromagnetics. So okay, these are the potential research, and then you now look for schools where people are doing those things. So my point is, you don't have to have it all figured out before starting. Sometimes in the process, in checking out some schools, like you would see some schools that maybe you want to check them out, you go to the faculty that you are in, and you check some of their profiles, and then you see that this person is doing this. Even from there, you can feel like, oh, this is something that I would want to work with. So my point is, you don't need to have it all figured out. The next thing that you can do is also, so maybe when you have a particular topic, after doing all this searching and you have a particular topic that you are interested in, what you can do is you can just go maybe Google Scholar or some of these research sites, and then just search that topic. There will be so much works that will come up on that field, and you can, on the papers, you know, some of them, the authors have their names there, and also some of them have their schools that they are in. And so then now I can show you like some schools that you should be looking at. You go check their profiles, their websites, and then now you you kind of get it going. I hope you get me. The other thing that you can also do is you can just search, okay, which school or what are the best schools in the field of electromagnetics. You see some schools pop up who like really invest a lot of things in developing innovative research in the field that you are interested in. And so basically the point I want to say is that you don't need to have it all figured out. Some countries, when you're applying, you need to have like a whole research proposal. Like maybe you need to know what you want to do, how you want to do it, the methods that you're going to apply, and so many other things. But if you are like me, you just have to do the things that I have suggested. And you know, sometimes you shouldn't even close your mind to a particular field. Like, you never know what you end up being interested in. So if you see someone that kind of like, you know, there's something that you feel like, yeah, I can do this thing, you should definitely go for it. Notwithstanding, I'm not saying select like a field that you know that you can't, I think you can do it, because everything is possible. But there are times where it's going to get hard. And if it gets hard and it's something that you are like so not interested in working in, it's going to be so difficult for you. Now, the next thing that I want to talk about is, So the next thing that I want to talk about is ways you can get a fully funded offer. So I got some questions on how can I get like a fully funded offer? So many, you know, questions about that. You know, there are two main ways. The first is, you know, putting in a general application. The department goes to and they say, hey, we want this student. So for the student to come, we are taking them as teaching assistants, where they will help the department in maybe grading courses and helping undergraduates. So that is one way. And another way is also contacting a professor who then becomes interested in working with you. So the professor gives you an assurance that they want to work with you, and they decide that they are going to, you know, pay your tuition and everything, like pay you for the work you'll be doing. And so that is like the main two ways. I also heard of an instance where a student just, you know, he was working in one country like that didn't speak English, and a professor from the US came, and because the student was so good with English, like, hey, I want to work with you. Those are like rare instances, but the first two are certain ways that you can get a fully funded offer. Now, the reason why I'm doing this video now is because this is the time. The application season has started, and if you want to start school maybe in spring or in fall next year, you definitely want to start or just start with everything. Now, it's important to have some documents ready, like your statements of purpose, your CV, your recommendations, and also your publications or writing samples. And maybe you start working on how you'll be able to get your GRE results if you want to write a GRE. And so those are very important things. For all the documents, I'm going to touch a little bit on them. So I just share certain things that I did that really, really helped. So the documents that you need, the first document that you need is your official transcript from you. Well, not really your official transcript, but your transcript from your school, because you would have to upload them on the application sites. And for that, most of the schools have ways that they can give you maybe an e-copy of your transcript to be able to do that. And so you just have to investigate how students from your school get transcripts for applications. And then the next thing, one thing that I want to mention is that you don't really need a first class to get a fully funded offer for your graduate school. It's all a matter of how, you know, holistic and how very good your application is. So if you know that maybe you are not so strong when it comes to your grades, you should know that, okay, that means that the other components of my application should be very strong. Maybe the research component, maybe your writing, your statement of purpose needs to be strong. Which brings me to statement of purpose. So your statement of purpose is basically it's like an essay where you talk about yourself and mostly about your background in your research, and then the field that you're interested in working in, why you're interested, why the school that you are selecting, and then which professors in the school's faculty would you like to work with. So basically, when we say a statement of purpose, that is more like all there is to it. However, sometimes some schools have certain instructions of what they want to see in your statement of purpose. So you also definitely have to investigate that as well. The next thing that you need also are your recommendation letters. Mostly I think the average number of recommendation letters that most schools require is 3. And by now, you should have spoken to your professors or the people that you would want to recommend, mostly your lecturers from your school. And if you feel like you didn't really build like a good connection with some of them, I think that this is the best time for you to, you know, maybe take a trip there, introduce yourself to them, tell them that you would like to get recommendation letters from them just for familiarity's sake, so they know you. Because sometimes when deadlines, you know, they are all busy, and when deadlines come, when they kind of know you, they will kind of like, you know, make sure that they get it down for you. Because sometimes you can email them and they will not respond, and it's not their fault, they are busy. And so you would like to get that, and also be prepared to write your own recommendation letters, because some of them are so busy that maybe like they just maybe, and some of them don't know you, so they'll just maybe ask for a sample, like maybe, okay, what are some of the things about you that they need to know or something like that, so they can write it for you. I don't know if this is good or bad advice, but just please make sure that you are on standby. You just have maybe a sample of what you'd like them to know. And you know, you should know what your school wants, certain candidates that your school is looking for, and know that you need to have or highlight some of the points in your recommendation letters and in your statement of purpose. The next thing that you need is your CV. It is so important. Some people say you don't really need that much, maybe like a lot of pages of your CV, but in academia, you kind of need the pages. So you should know how you're going to break everything that you've done down. And no matter how little something is on your resume, okay, there's a way you can do it, you know, to like, I don't know how to put it, but to make it sophisticated and very good and very strong for an application. Because it's very important to be able to present whatever that you've done, no matter how small it is, to them. Because mostly if you're an undergraduate, you've not really done a lot of things, so they are not really expecting so much from you. But you need to show them potential now, so you need to, you know, spice your CV, and it's very important. Also about GRE, okay, so what I would advise is that I realized that I did, you know, I contacted some professors, and some of them asked me for my GRE results. Like in some of the schools, they are like, oh, GRE is optional and all that, but then there are so many students like, so with the GRE, what I would advise is that if you can, please take it, because some of the professors kind of ask for it, because there are lots of candidates and they need to be able to shortlist. So it can go as down as your GRE to be able to select an, like maybe a top applicant. And so if you can, it's very important for you to write it well, because it will kind of like, you know, give you a certain leverage as compared to maybe an applicant that did not apply. Maybe if everything, you are both on the same level, there needs to be something that maybe distinguishes you from them. And so in that case, a GRE can really help. And because I had quite good, you know, GRE results, I think it really, really helped me in securing some of these professors' interests as well. If you can, please take it. And the next thing that you need is also a writing sample or publications. When I say a writing sample, it can even be your undergraduate thesis. Most of us use undergraduate thesis because, I mean, we weren't really doing so much research in our schools, and the schools kind of need, because in graduate school, you'll be writing a lot of papers and doing a lot of writing, and they need to know, can this person communicate effectively? If they have an idea or if they have results, are they able to effectively communicate it to an audience? It's very important. And so your undergraduate thesis can really help. And if you have publications, that's like an additional, like an add-on to it. Now I want to talk about application costs, because it's a very, very important aspect of graduate school applications. Some people really want to apply, but they're like, I don't have money. And it's like so true, because even right now in Ghana, the dollar conversion rate, like I'm really like really sad about it, because I feel like it can prevent people. But I bring good news. Yeah. There, you can actually get application fee waivers, and there are ways you can get them, because hey, if you're like me and you're going to be applying to like over 10 schools, you are definitely not going to be able to sponsor all of them. And so how then do you, you know, capitalize on other things and like, you know, make sure that you are at least getting some waivers here and there? And I'm going to share some ways you can get them. Now is the time for you to be looking out for open house sessions or information sessions. Some of these schools do information sessions that kind of briefs potential students about their whole application process and some of the things that they do. Now, they guarantee to give you a fee waiver after participating in the event. It's usually an online event, maybe a Zoom meeting, and you get a waiver afterwards. And so please be looking out for schools and schools that have like information sessions coming up, and then definitely register. Another way of doing that is by contacting the graduate admissions office. Sometimes you contact them and then you tell them about your current situation and how you are really interested in the school, but you have a financial challenge that will prevent you from applying. Some of them can respond and then give you waivers. However, if you don't get a response from that, there is also another way. Some schools, in fact, I think most schools have graduate school coordinators, like graduate school coordinator, like the directors for the program. Please look for those people and then contact them as well, because they can really help. I think I was trying to contact one school for a waiver and I wasn't getting a response. Like, I wasn't getting a response from them, and the deadline was approaching, and I'm like, I went through their list and then I saw the graduate school coordinator and I contacted the coordinator about it, and voila, I just had my waiver. And so that is also another field that you would want to explore. Now, another thing and the last thing that I want to talk about with the application course is when you have or when you're in contact with a professor who wants to work with you, don't feel shy. Like, some people feel shy or feel like if I ask this professor maybe like to waive my application fee, it will make them disinterested in me. No, please. Most of the, especially if they've expressed their interest in working with you, are definitely going to try and make sure that you apply so they can get you. And so don't feel shy. You know, if you don't ask for anything, the answer is always no. And so you definitely want to make sure that you are asking. If you ask and you are rejected, then you know that you have to find a way of making money. And so after you've explored all these options I've given you, then you decide if they are still not giving you the offer, you decide maybe you can ask your friends and your loved ones if they can help. Now, the thing I would like to talk about, like general stuff, you know, tracking your applications. There's like so many. If you're like me, you're going to do plenty schools, you need to track them, okay? And I'm going to use this to recommend certain things. Like, the first thing that I want to recommend is that the easiest way to get a fully funded offer is by contacting a professor. Like, it's like the surest way. And I hate to break this news to you, but you are going to email a lot of professors and a lot of them are not going to respond because they are busy. Like, and they get a lot of emails and they don't have time to really scan through. But that shouldn't stop you. If you have to send like 100 emails, I'm being realistic here, like send 100 emails, even if 10 or 2 or 5 respond to you, you never know who is going to be interested in you. So my point is, don't give up when lecturers or professors are not responding to you. They are definitely busy and some of them will respond. One tip for this is that make sure that the email that you send, don't send an email like, "Hi, professor, maybe I'm interested in working with you. Let's talk further." You're not going to get the interest. So what I was recommended by from my mentor, okay, is that like when you send your email to your professor, right there you need to have like an SOP, a whole SOP attached to it, to talk about yourself, your background, everything that you want to do, why your interest aligns with them and how you would want to work with them. It's so important. So it's like you're serving them all the information at the same time. They don't have to like maybe, "Hi, hello, how are you?" Maybe, "I'm fine." You're not going to get a response. And so when you do that, after the person reads and they're like, they look at, when you do that, you need to attach your CV as well and then your official transcript. When they look through all those and they're like, "Hey, this looks like a strong potential candidate, I need to reach out," they will reach out to you and you definitely have an interview with them. And